Okay, let's talk about Thomas Young's double slit experiments. In about 18, I think it was 1801, Thomas Young did this experiment using a setup similar to this. This is looking at it from above. And we have a light source here, and what he did, he fired light towards two slits. So the light could pass through these slits and hit this observation screen here. Now, if we think about light as a particle, or consisting of particles, what we'd expect to see is that they'd go through these slits, something like this, and give us two blobs here on the observation screen. But this isn't what Thomas Young saw. What Thomas Young saw was he got a blob there, something like this. What he got, in fact, was an interference pattern. And the only way you can really explain an interference pattern like this is by considering light to be a wave. So if we send it towards these slits as a wave, it'll pass through these slits as a wave. And these two waves then will interfere with each other, giving us points of constructive interference here and destructive interference in between. We see nothing there. Okay, I've got Thomas Young's original sketch here, or a copy of Thomas Young's original sketch, showing the points of interference here. And we can see that the only way you can explain this is by considering light to be a wave. Okay. Now, let me just redraw this. Okay, we're gonna think about it like this. Let's think about these two slits here. We have a distance to the center of these slits, which we're going to call small d. We have a distance to the observation screen, which we're going to call big D. Okay, now back to this for a minute. We can do this experiment using light, electrons. It's been done with atoms. It's been done all the way up to carbon 60, quite a heavy molecule. And the interference pattern is still seen. So it's not just light that behaves in this way. All matter appears to behave in this way as well, to some degree. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later, but if we think about doing this experiment now with electrons, we can slow the electron beam down so that only one particle or one electron can go through a slit at any one time. And if we do that, let's think this, imagine this to be the observation screen here. If we slow these particles right down, what we see is this. We see it hit the screen as a particle. And then we see another one hit, and another one hit, and another one hit, and so on. And if we let this go, what we see is that these particles hitting the screen build up an interference pattern. Like so. So, if we think about what the particle coming from the gun here, going through the slit and hitting the screen, could come through this, let's say it hits a, okay, hold on, sorry. Let's say the particle hits the screen here. We'll call that P. That particle could have come from that slit, or it could have come from that slit. And we'll call them, call that one R1, and that path R2, R1 and R2 being the length of this path from the slit to the point at which the particle hits the screen. We've also got the centre of the screen here, and this point P is some distance away from the centre of the screen, which we call X. We find that we get points of constructive interference where the path difference R1 and R2 is an integer number of wavelengths. We can look at it like this. We can say that R1 minus R2 is equal to X times D all over the distance to the screen, big D. Now this is true if D is much smaller than big D. Okay, if this isn't true, things start getting messed up. We don't need to really think about that now. When the experiment's set up like this, this is how we can describe our points of constructive interference. And I think considering this, I don't want to really go into this too deeply at the moment. We'll do more about it later, but I think I'll just say that the idea of wave-particle duality comes from this. And what that means is that these things that are giving us either particles or giving us waves, we don't really know what they are, so we just call them quantum particles. So when we're talking about a quantum particle, we're talking about something that can either be a wave or a particle. And I think it's just important to know that for now. And also, like I said earlier, this experiment has been done up to carbon 60 molecule, and this wave-like nature has been seen in heavy molecules as well. And the first person to say that matter could have this wave-like nature was Louis de Broglie, and we'll have a look in the next video at how Louis de Broglie thought about things.